Hey, good morning. I'm not Pastor Bill, I'm Pastor Art. Pastor Bill has the pink eye. I told him to keep it there. We don't want that stuff, do we? No, I haven't had that since I've been a kid. So here I am, and we're going to celebrate today and worship the Lord and just have a great time. And remember, Mama's Day. This is Mom's Day today, a special day. I'll talk to the children about that in a little bit, and we'll do some special things. All right? Let me do the announcements here for you. The Joyful Hands meeting is on Tuesday at 6:15. All ladies are welcome. That looks like a great event, doesn't it? May 14th is Men of the Church meeting. All men are welcome, I presume. Yes, okay. It doesn't say that, but I'm saying that they are. And Youth Group Progressive Dinner is next Sunday at 4 o'clock. Starts here at the church, and then we're going to be going around different places. And look at Vacation Bible School. How many of you love Vacation Bible School? I love it, don't you? Yeah. It's going to be the Surf Shack. Grab your board. All right. I'm expecting to see a lot of surfboards. It's going to be the fun. June the 20th, which happens to be the day after my birthday, you know, June the 20th, and through the 24th. So it's going to be great. Ages 3 through 11. We need volunteers. If you can help us, just give a little bit of your time. Call Anita. All right? We'll get on that. Any other announcements that we need to make? Well, it's great that you're going to be here today and worship as we come. Please take your prayer request. I take these home and put them on your refrigerator. Then you can see them and you can pray for people during the week. And there's all kinds of things that you want to get involved with the senior adult ministry. It's right there. No age rules. I like that, isn't that? That's cool. And youth meet on the last Sunday. And just a quick synopsis of last Sunday, the young adults, which I think we'll call us the Yay group. Isn't that fun? The Yah group. Isn't that funny? Yeah, the Yah group. We had a good group, and we had some good plans. And check us out on Facebook what we're going to be doing. We're going to be starting a Bible study here, and we're going to be doing some service ministry together. I was real excited about the group that came, and there's others that said they wanted to come and will be there with us and come join us, all right? All right, well, let's continue to worship the Lord on this beautiful day. I think it's time to acknowledge any birthdays. Yeah, I can't forget that. Yes, ma'am. All right, congratulations. What a great day. Anybody else have a birthday? You're the only one? All right. You have a birthday? She has a birthday on Tuesday? Great. Where's Mom? Sitting way over there, and you're sitting over here. Okay. Good thinking, Mom. Yes, ma'am, Miss Elsa. Teresa has a birthday today. All right. Mac was yesterday. 51 Mac is. All right. He's doing great. All right. Yeah. All right. Well, let's sing happy birthday. Okay.
Happy birthday.
Oh, thank you. Y'all sing wonderful, wonderful. If all the children would come forward, I want to talk with you about a few things. Man, I love all these kids. There's the future church right there, I'm telling you. Isn't it? I served this church one time. I'm not going to tell you where it was. And they said, you got too many kids coming here. And I said, what's wrong with you? I moved the next year. I said, I want to be where the kids are, you know? How y'all doing?
Good.
Today is a special day. What day is it?
Mother's Day.
Yeah. Did you know when it started?
Today.
Oh, it started today. Okay. Well. Actually, it started in 1908. None of us were around here then, by Anna Jarvis. Did you know that? It became official holiday in 1914. We weren't around then either. It's always the second Sunday in May. Do you know there are more phone calls made on Mother's Day than any other day?
No.
Did you know that? Well, now you know. Okay. It's a way of honoring the sacrifices that mothers have done for us and what they've done for the children. It started in a church in 1908 in Grafton, West Virginia. Who's from West Virginia? No one? Okay. President Woodrow Wilson in 1914 made the day official by a proclamation. Isn't that something? Now you know a little bit about Mother's Day. What can we do for our mothers on this day? Flowers. What else? Take them to Applebee's. Yeah. Buy them chocolates. I'm liking this. Yep. I won't hear you. Yeah. Well, what'd you say? Flowers and stuff like that. Yeah. What about what? Anybody else? Do all the chores in the house. Yeah, I like that. Yes, I'm coming back.
Make a card.
Yeah, I like that. What else? Did you have something? Okay, anybody else? Well, you know, oh, one more. Yes. Oh, I love it. Lots of love. Isn't that great? Wow, there are all kinds of moms, aren't there? There's moms, there's grandmoms, there's nanas, great-grandmoms. There's single moms, you know. I really think of them on this day also. And I want us to just find out something today. Who is the youngest mom here? Who's under 30? Anybody? All right, I got to go. 35. Anybody can beat 35? Uh-oh. Tell us your age, Mom. 33, a couple more days. 32. Who can beat 32? Well, stand up. We want to congratulate you. The youngest mom. You get to take me lunch sometime. All right. All right. Who is the most mature mom here? Who can beat 85 plus? Are you the most maturest mom here?
She's been on for 72 years.
I don't think we can beat that. Let's show her our congratulations. Great, great. That's wonderful, that's wonderful. You know, I don't have a mom anymore and I miss my mom. And this is usually a hard day for me because my mom passed away on Mother's Day. So I always, it kind of has mixed feelings about it. But I'm going to celebrate with all you moms today. And we want to thank, don't we, kids? Yeah. All the women in this church. Would all the women in the church stand up and let's just give them a great round of applause. If you're a woman, stand up. All right. Some of us don't know yet. All right, thank you, thank you, thank you. Some of us didn't know what we were yet. Okay, that's all right. You work on that today, okay? All right, let's have a prayer. Join in prayer and repeat after me. Dear God, thank you for our moms and our families. We love you and this church. Amen. Thank you for helping me. Y'all did so well. I'm proud of you all. Thanks. All right, we're going to children's church?
We are.
We are. Oh, we got our boots on. Come on, we're going fishing. Who's taking me to Applebee's? All right. You will? I like Applebee's. It's good. All right. Thank y'all. Y'all did a great job. You did? Okay. Thank you.
back home to the garden alone, while the dew is still on the roses, and the voice I hear calling on my ear, the Son of God discloses, and he walks with me and he talks with me. He tells me I am his own, and the joy we share as we tarry there, none other. He speaks, and the sound of his voice, so sweet the touch they're singing, and the melody that he gives me within my heart is ringing. And he walks with me, and he talks with me. He tells me that I am his own. And the joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever known. I'd stay in the garden with him, through the night around me falling, but he bids me go. To the voice of love, his voice to me is calling. And he walks with me and he talks with me. He tells me that I am his own. And the joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever known. Yes, the joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever known.
You know, I really love the music here at this church, don't you?
Amen.
It's just great. Amen. You know, music, there's a lot of theology that's taught in music. You know, especially in the black culture, a lot of slaves and people were not educated, could not read, and they would sing their theology. And that's why I just love hymns. Thank you for the music. God just gives us that music. And it's just, it does something to me. It moves me. It prepares us, Pastor Bill and I, to give the message. Do you have any joys you'd like to share today before we just have a pastoral care? Any joy you'd like to share? This joy of that man? Okay. That's good.
Have a joy over here also.
Great. That's great. I like that. Anything, any joys you want to share? Yeah, we don't share enough joys with each other. Yes, ma'am.
I was joyful when I pulled up the parking lot and the church bells were ringing.
Yeah, wasn't that great to hear that?
Yeah. Billy West.
Billy West and Joel worked on that, yeah.
It wasn't raining.
And it wasn't raining. Yeah. Billy was building the ark. I think he stopped, though. Yes, ma'am.
The song that Joel just sang.
In the
garden.
In the garden.
Right,
walks with me and talks with me. Beautiful. God is just a wonderful God of surprises. Yes, ma'am.
Our granddaughter has a
cancer
and it's all gone. And
the
man says,
all
there.
All gone. Oh, praise God for that. Praise God for that. What's your name?
Ava.
All right. Yes, sir.
I have a joy. I stayed with this woman for 64 years.
That's wonderful. patient woman, right? Any other joys? Isn't it? See all these children here, just do something to me. It's wonderful, isn't it? You know, a lot of churches don't have children. Y'all are doing great things here, and I'm glad I'm a part of it. Thank you. Any other joys you may have?
Had orders with us today.
Great, great. It's good to have you. Yeah, my daughter, she got in late last night. She's with us. And our three grandsons are here. The house is never the same once they come, you know? Yes, ma'am.
My son has bought a home in that Sarah is coming home.
All right, her son is coming home. That's great. After 30 years, praise God. Praise God. All right. Do you have any prayer concerns that you would have? We have listed in the back people, but you have anything you'd like to lift up this morning before we go to God in prayer? Anything? Yes. Edwards and Crawford. Thank you. Thank you. Not asking you to pray for my daughter, Amy Johnson. You know there's a power release when you pray. Something happens. Let's go to God in prayer. God, we are so blessed to be here today. You've given us another day to be in your world. We know this is only our temporary home, that one day we will be with all those mothers and all children and all people that we've loved that have gone on in the faith. We hold on to that truth, Lord Jesus. We know, as Joe saying, it started in a garden and it ends in a garden. And we now are helping you as tillers of that garden, working those gardens. We are grateful for all the women in this church. We are grateful for their nurturing, their care, and giving all of us life. We ask God, where women are oppressed and are suffering, God, we pray in the name of Jesus that be stopped, they be set free. We pray, God, where mothers are struggling to feed their families, we pray, God, that they'll find food and that you will use us in some way and others of your faith to make a difference in this world. The chimes reminded us this morning, God, that we are on holy ground. This is a very special place just out here in the country. But it's your place, and you live here and dwell here, and we're grateful to be here. I ask, God, that you be with especially the women who are serving in the armed forces that are maybe away from their families, that you just bless them, give them your peace, and all others who protect us in the armed forces, so that we have the freedom to be here and get up and come to worship today. We've shared a lot of good news today, Lord. Some of our children coming home to live after so many years. Some of our families back together. And I just pray, God, that we continue to be faithful because you are always faithful to us. What you do, you say you will do. I pray now, God, that you just open our hearts and minds as we continue to worship today, and that we will feel your presence and learn your truths through the music, the prayers, and the hymns, and the message. In Jesus' name I pray. Will you join me in the Lord's Prayer? Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Thank you.
each week we have the honor to give our tithes and offering to God. So I ask that you prepare your hearts for this time, and the ushers come forward, and we will receive these at this time. Our prayer, please.
Our most gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you we can assemble in your house and worship your holy name. And dear Lord, we ask our blessings upon these gifts that have been brought forth this morning, and help us use them wisely for the advancement of the great King. In the wonderful and merciful name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Amen. Aren't you glad that there's a kingdom coming? Wow. Amen. Pray with me, please. Lord, open our hearts and minds to your truth, and that I, Art, may be out of your way, and you speak through us today, through the sharing of this lessons and this proclamation. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. That Billy, I tell you, he's a stinker. I told him, I've been here 2 months and you've called in sick twice on me now. I said, that's okay. I said, what's June going to bring, Billy? He said, I'm not telling you. I'm supposed to be
privilege to speak next Sunday, so I hope you'll come back. We're going to talk about prayer next Sunday, about the woman who met the unrighteous judge. I've been thinking about that, and I wanted to share that with you, what I thought about that and reflections on that. But today I'm going to read to you from 2 Timothy chapter 4. 2 Timothy. You'll find that it's in near, close to Revelations, 1 Peter. You'll follow that after Corinthians. And to give you just a little background of what this is about, this is Paul's letter to Timothy. He's a very young pastor, got his hands full, doesn't know very much. Paul is writing to give encouragement, writing to tell the leaders of the church how they should behave. Paul is telling us through Timothy that we need to keep the faith. We need to be strong in our faith. Timothy's mother was Eunice. You biblical scholars will know that. And she was a strong woman of faith, a strong Jewish woman. And so she produced a great son. So Paul is writing to Timothy to tell him how to keep his life pure and to give him guidance and spiritual growth. And that's what we're going to talk about today. He's a young minister. He's in charge of public worship, prayer, and sometimes the most challenging order in the church. So let's see what Paul is telling Timothy in chapter 4, 2 Timothy chapter 4. Follow along with me in verse 3. For the time is coming when people will not put up with sound doctrine, but having itching ears, they will accumulate for themselves teachers to suit their own desires, and they will turn away from listening to the truth and wander away to the myths. But as for you, always be sober, endure sufferings, do the work of an evangelist, carry out your ministry fully. As for me, Paul says, I'm already being poured out as a libation, and the time of my departure has come. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. From now on, there is reserved for me the crown of righteousness, Paul says, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will give me on that day, and not only to me, but also to all who have longed for his appearing. Amen. What a beautiful scripture, isn't that? Talks to us about that, what we need to do, the times that we're in. If you can turn back just a few pages in Timothy, let's listen to me. Let me read it to you, because Billy talked about this last week. 1 Timothy chapter 4, if you can find it with me, but listen more, it's important. The Spirit expressly says that in later times, some will renounce the faith by paying attention to deceitful spirits and teaching of demons. Wow. That's what Billy talked to us about last week, didn't we? The ghosts aren't real, but demons are. And I have met, like Billy, people who have had demons. And it is a frightening thing if you've never been around that. I read something once and I share it with you. Read the Bible even if you don't understand it, because the demons do and they tremble. Wasn't it true that when Jesus came into a village, many times the demons would call out Jesus' name? Jesus, Son of God, what do you have to do with us? See, they knew who Jesus was even before the disciples fully got it. They knew what was going on. So Paul is writing to this young preacher, and he's telling him this, as he's telling us today, that we've got to keep the faith. We've got to keep the faith. Faith is from God, isn't it? It is assurance of things not seen. It's our belief, our trust. Our mothers, we have faith in them, don't we? Someone took care of us when we were young. We don't even maybe remember that time. But someone fed us, somebody clothed us, washed us. That's faith in him. That here we are today. I remember this story of a nun, and she broke down on 64, going to Richmond. And she walked up to the exit. She had run out of gas. And she walked up to the exit, and she went into the filling station, and she told the man, she said, "I need some gas." He said, "Well, sister, I don't have any gas cans. People take them, and they don't ever bring them back. But you go in the back room and find whatever you want, and you fill it up with a gallon gas. I'll give you a gallon gas." Well, my friend, she went, and the only thing she could find was a urinal. She filled it up with a gallon of gas. She walked back down on 64, and she's pouring this into her gas tank, and the state trooper came up behind her and just looked at her and said, "Oh, sister, if I had your faith." "Oh, sister, if I had your faith." That's what you and I have to keep the faith, don't we? And it's hard. Pastor Billy talked to us about this a few weeks ago. How people are turning to everything. They want cheap grace. Dietrich Bonhoeffer, a Lutheran pastor, would say cheap grace costs God a lot. There is no cheap grace. Grace is God's riches at Christ's expense, isn't it? That's what it means. We get those riches, what God has done for us in Christ Jesus. So, what is faith? It's a belief, isn't it? A trust. When you tell your child to jump down from that tree and you're going to catch him or her, that's a trust, isn't it? A belief. It's an assurance of things not seen. That's what the Bible tells us. Mr. Wesley would say it like this: faith is the evidence of God's love that can secure our trust and confidence. Faith is the evidence of God's love that can secure our trust and confidence. My faith in God, how about you? I love these signs around our county. No matter what, trust God. I acquired one of those. I picked one up on the side of the road. I don't know if you're supposed to do that, but I went and... I don't know where you get them. If someone does, tell me, okay? Well, I went and took one to this person that was really struggling with their faith, and I put it in their front yard. I got a call. "Pastor Arndt, did you nail that in my front yard?" "Yes, I did. Thank you. Thank you." I took a leap of faith, didn't I? I didn't get picked up by the Gloucester Sheriff. I went and put this in somebody's yard. But I felt that I needed to do that. Have faith in God, Matthew says, and nothing else. No matter what, trust God, the signs say. Hebrew 11 says this, friends: now faith is the assurance of things hoped for, the conviction of things not seen. Ah, see, we can't always see it, but we can feel it. Paul is writing to a struggling preacher, and he's saying, keep the faith. And secondly, I want us to always know that we have a message in us, don't we? Not just Billy and myself. All of us have a message. You have something to say, don't you? You have something to tell. Someone said, you know, preaching is this. Karl Barth, that's it. Good Presbyterian. Preaching is telling one beggar where the other beggar is to get the bread. Where you get the bread. And the bread is the Word of God, isn't it? And we need that bread. We need to be fed, don't we? Proclaim the message. who you are and whose you are. Use scripture, Paul is writing to Timothy, for the maturity of the congregation. Be faithful to your mission of the church. Too many people have watered down theology. They don't have the faith. Too many things just go now, don't they? Too many churches just preach, oh, I want to make you feel good. But they don't address the issue. And the issue is this, isn't it? For God so loved the world that he gave his only son, so that you and I may live. We struggle with sin, don't we? I do. I'm not going to take any more signs, I promise. I'll get Pastor Bill to do it next time. But we have to be faithful to the mission of the church. And what is the mission of the church? Huh? Huh? Spread the word. Make disciples. God doesn't really care much about how many dinners we have and how many bake sales. He likes those things. But he wants to know that we are making a difference in the community. And I feel you are doing that. Praise God for that. But we've got to be faithful to our mission, to spread the word, to make disciples. It is the most important responsibility of the church that you've come in here and now you go out changed as a different person, right? And you and I always be ready to share the good news. The good news is this: for God so loved the world that he gave his only son for us. That is powerful, man. Paul goes on and tells Timothy, he said, there are times that we need to rebuke, we need to challenge one another, we need to get each other on the right track, and that's okay. But do it in the spirit of love and gentleness and kindness. But always follow God and obey God. I read something, and I share it with you. And you know, United Methodists always like to have church meetings. I mean, they have a meeting to have a meeting. You know, I used to get so tired of those things. And I said something one Sunday, and people looked at me strange. I said, you know, people will not remember our church meetings, but they will remember how we loved them, how we cared for them here, how we taught them how to be disciples. And finally, we get to the message point. The time is coming when people will have itchy ears. I always wondered about that, you know. Revelations 2:4 says, don't abandon your love for God. The Bible is a love story, isn't it? It's about God's love for us and how much God loves us. We are God's people. Our faith comes through hearing, doesn't it? In the Word of God and through the power of the Holy Spirit. The time is coming, though, when people will give that up. They'll look for their own doctrine. They'll look for the easy way. They'll look for only feeling good. Someone said, and I like this, the church is the hospital for sinners. Amen? I like that. I got to be in here all the time. I got to get right. I got to get right. That's what grace is about, isn't it? Growing in God's riches for what Christ has done for us. Keep your cool when you're jolted. Keep your cool when you're challenged. Don't react, respond. It's easy to react, isn't it? But respond. Stay focused in God's word. Stay focused on the love of Jesus Christ. As Paul was nearing the end of his life, he's writing this letter to Timothy. He's facing death already, but he has the ability to give these words. Carry on your ministry. Do your best for Christ. Make your life like a fragrant offering pleasing to God. I like that, don't you? Make your life like a fragrant offering, pleasing to God. I thought about Jesus when he was near his death and Mary Magdalene anointed his feet with that fragrance. And in his time of death and suffering, in all that midst of that, he still smelled that fragrance. Somebody cared enough about me that in my suffering and death, I could still feel that and smell that fragrance. You and I need to be that fragrance. You and I need to be that perfume for God. That everywhere we go, we make a difference. I was having lunch with a couple men the other day, and we were laughing and we were carrying on, and we had prayer before we ate, and the waitress came over and said, "I noticed you guys are really having a good time. Are you some type of Christians?" I said, "Yeah, it's okay." She said, "Well, I want what you got." Ah. I gave her a little Bible that I had. People are hungry, aren't they? They're hungry for the truth. They're hungry for a relationship with God. And they're hungry for a relationship with each other. I believe that. That's why people come to church. Finally, finish the race, as Paul would say to Timothy. And Paul talks about that. He has run the race, hasn't he? He will cross the finish line. And he will receive the reward. Look in that, chapter 4. I have kept the faith, verse 7. From now on there is reserved for me the crown of righteousness. And the righteous judge will give me on that day, not only to me, but to all who have longed for his appearing. Wow, that's the reward. You will endure suffering, Paul says to Timothy. But you need to work as an evangelist. Carry out your ministry. Do you know that I believe from 1 Peter, you can look it up, that we are all ministers. We are all called to the royal priesthood. Billy and I have decided to make this our career, that we are ordained ministers. But all of you are ministers. All of you have something that you can give to God. Let God take that and use that. Amen? The church needs people with passion. The church needs people who care, who love God, who have a triumphant spirit. We are the Easter people. Yeah? Not Easter just comes once. We are the Easter people. We are the resurrected people. A church excited about their faith will be excited about God. And people will want to be around them. That's why I like to be around you all. Because you all love God. Faith is that which is unseen but guaranteed in Christ. Wow. Faith is that which is unseen but guaranteed in Christ. Maybe your faith's been a little weak. Mine gets weak at times. I love that hymn, "Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness." You know? We'll have to sing that sometime. I like that. Yeah. Did I ever tell you the story in closing that my faith was really challenged one time when I met Eileen? Have I ever told y'all this story? Eileen's not here, is she? Eileen, all right, Eileen. I really loved Eileen. She was tall and lean, had the biggest brown eyes. She was a Maasai giraffe, and I was her keeper when I worked at King's Dominion. Eileen was beautiful. She had the most beautiful long legs, and she was gentle. I had the privilege of hearing her make a sound. Many people say giraffes are non-vocal. But I got to hear her speak to me one night. I don't know if it was indigestion or what, but she went, "Bruh." I said, "Eileen, it's nice to meet you too." She had a 17-inch tongue, Mac, and she'd just bring it down under my throat like that. Just lick me. What she was doing was getting the salt off my body. She didn't have any desire for me or anything. But when I needed a boost, I'd just go sit in the barn with her and the other giraffes and just watch them and listen to them. Eileen was 15 months pregnant. The gestation is 17 months. You think about that, Mom, carrying a baby that long. I was in local pastor school at Randolph-Macon. To become a local pastor in the tradition of the United Methodist Church, you had to go to local pastor school before you went to seminary and became ordained. I was in local pastor school, and I knew that Eileen was very close to having this baby. It's our first one we're going to have at King's Dominion. Vicky, my wife, came and got me, and she had a very sad look on her face. She said, "You need to come now. Eileen's in trouble." I got to her house where we kept her, and she was down. Now, giraffes have babies standing up, like horses, I guess, because they got to drop them quick, get them up, right? So lions and tigers and bears, oh my, won't get them, right? Well, she was down, and they were giving her gallons of IV Ringer solution in her jugular vein. And we had a great vet, B.J. Campbell from Hanover, just graduated from Virginia Tech. And she looked at me and she said, "It's your call." I said, "What do you mean it's my call?" I said, "Tell me what's going to happen. We're going to lose Eileen." I said, "No. Still hurts me. But we can maybe save the baby." "Okay, BJ, what do we do?" "We give her a C-section." I said, "Okay." See, I had to make that call. I was the management. I had to make that call. Tough call. We did the C-section. We had this beautiful female giraffe. We lost Eileen. She died. But it wouldn't breathe. We gave her mouth-to-mouth everything. She just would not breathe. This was one of the lowest days of my life. Lost two beautiful animals. And my faith was really challenged. I said, "God, why? Haven't you said that before? Why? How can this happen?" Faith is the conviction of things not seen. That's what I heard that day. So I took both of them in a dump truck to the National Zoo, and they did an autopsy on them. Well, I got to call the ministry when I was 31. I left there, but I was still a volunteer chaplain there. I would go back and talk to the employees and help them. I remember somebody asked me, "Doug," one day, I had my chaplain badge on, they said, "This place that rough, you got to have a chaplain here?" I said, "Oh, no, we work with the employees. We work with the employees." And I remember somebody asked me, said, "Why do they have all this asphalt in this park, like Busch Gardens?" I said, "It's so hot here." I said, "Yeah, they do that so you'll buy more drinks. I mean, they're smart. They want you to do that. You know, buy more stuff, right?" Well, 2 years later, St. John Arthur was born. From another giraffe. They named it after me, Arthur. I said, "Thank you, God." See, we don't always understand when we're going through these things, do we? We're like the disciples in the boat. "Don't you care that we perish, Lord?" And he says, "Yes, you know I love you more than anything. Peace be still." So whatever you're going through, whatever I go through, know that God's in the middle of it. And God's going to bring us to a point. We don't always understand it, do we? But we will one day. Our life is like a piece of the puzzle, isn't it? It all comes together. And then you see it. Then you see it. So my prayer today is, if your faith has been challenged, if you're struggling with that,
Just remember what Paul wrote to Timothy. Endure this suffering, knowing that it will not last forever. That you'll come through it. I'll calm the storms of your life. I'll be with you always. That's what Emmanuel means, you know. From Jesus being born, Emmanuel means God be with us. God is with us. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. Let's sing our hymn, Just As I Am, and then I'll give the benediction. And if you'd like to have a word with me or just speak with me or just come and recommit your life to Christ, come and do that. Just As I Am. Thank you.